we continue to discover new things, even on this little island in Singapore. There is no formula to it. You never negotiate with Mother Nature. But not all human nature interface end up happy. We are literally removing their homes and created ours. Today, we are doing the opposite.
Now you see a thriving city in nature. The saying is, of course, you cannot protect what you do not love. You cannot love what you do not understand. You cannot understand what you are not taught. So we are starting from the ground up. Singapore is, amongst all other cities in the world, one where you can find critically endangered animals living next to people.
Because we created a home for them.
Lim Leong Jim leads the Conservation Division of the National Parks Board. He sits at the heart of Singapore's journey to recover lost biodiversity.
City in nature is a journey we are on. We do all have to endeavor to not ever take it for granted.
Especially given the city's complicated history with nature. Before the 1800s, Singapore was home to a wide array of wildlife.
When we were colonized, we were turned into a very large plantation, especially for rubber.
When the British established the island of Singapore as a trading hub in 1819, they cleared nearly 90% of its native forests to grow cash crops. That eventually eliminated more than a third of Singapore's biodiversity. Iconic species like the three-striped ground squirrel, green dragon-tailed butterfly, and Malayan tiger disappeared from the island. After a brief stint as part of Malaysia, Singapore gained its independence in 1965, setting off a period of rapid industrialization. But the new leaders of the city-state balanced that development with a plan to go green.
The most important thing, if you have a city-state like ours, is to basically focus on livability. It started out with a tagline, Garden City. Garden City looks at curated greenery. Trees along our roadsides, very well-managed parks, being available to people to socialize in, to do their recreation in.
Singapore planted over 55,000 trees between 1967 and 1970 across an island about the size of New York City. Species were chosen for their ability to grow quickly, even if they were non-native. By the time Khew Sin Khoon arrived in the 80s as a young architect from Malaysia, many new buildings were also being gardenized.
Singapore was developing its own brand of greenery. Because of our Garden City concept, many of our projects required greenery to be incorporated as part of the building site.
But Khew found this Garden City approach too manicured, as it favored human function over biodiversity and wildlife.
You go down to downtown Singapore, there are still buildings of concrete, glass and steel. They're very functional. They're not necessarily environmentally friendly. Greenery is just a decoration, an embellishment after the building has been designed.
Khew wanted to design in a way that integrated nature more seamlessly.
We started looking at vertical greenery. If you go into a forest, what are the kinds of vines that grow up? And we try to replicate that through biomimicry in buildings.
Khew had a lifelong passion for the natural world, and especially butterflies. He actually authored the first comprehensive photographic guide to the more than 300 butterfly species that live in Singapore. And he began to apply his love of nature to the design of airports, government buildings, and offices, all to enhance human connectivity to the natural environment. Then, in 2006, Khew won the commission of a lifetime. A chance to design a hospital that would welcome nature for the benefit of wildlife and patients alike.
You walk into a hospital and you don't get the hospital antiseptic smell.
Instead, visitors are treated to three ponds and 14 tropical gardens that cover a horizontal and vertical surface area nearly four times the size of the plot of land that the hospital sits on.
The flora and fauna were selected based on native species that attract birds, dragonflies, butterflies. Over time, the different critters came to appreciate what the flora can do for them, and they started visiting this environment.
Simon Chan monitors the animal visitor count.
We had a pangolin in 2017. The otters came in like a family of 10, but they wipe out all our fish.
Nature being nature, just like in the wild. High above the man-made pond, a rooftop garden provides organic food for patients and support for a wide range of pollinators, including Khew's favorites.
When we first started, there were only three butterfly species found. Today, the most recent count was 114 species.
We have discovered about 36 species of dragonflies. The number of species of birds, it's at a count of 96 and increasing.
They are important as an indicator of the health of the environment.
The benefits of the design aren't limited to wildlife. They also reach the human population.
People heal faster in a green environment. Ability to look out the window, see greenery, you know, finding peace as they heal.
I like going for a holiday instead of coming to a hospital.
Anyone is welcome here, as Khew designed these spaces to be open to the local community.
Many of the people who come to the hospitals are not patients. And there are people who actually come with cameras, like butterfly enthusiasts or bird people.
This is about introducing nature back to Singapore. The things that we have lost in those years of industrialization and rapid development.
The hospital's approach foreshadowed a shift in Singapore's broader relationship with wild spaces.
We continue to evolve into a city in nature.
In 2020, Singapore made this evolution official, changing from a garden city to a city in nature.
What's the difference between city in nature and garden city? City in nature takes it one step further when we are talking about having a functioning urban ecosystem. It means that the nature that surrounds you, the urban infrastructure which is covered in greenery, all contribute to helping people and animals live better.
That means bringing biodiversity back, which then makes the ecosystem itself more stable and healthy.
The more diversity you have, the more it's able to withstand any sort of shock to the system.
The groundwork for a city in nature was laid in 2005, just a year before Khew's firm began designing the hospital. To support natural resilience, the nation not only strengthened protection for its reforested nature reserves, it expanded them with new nature parks.
They literally look like a forest, a matrix of green spaces.
These rewilded areas were then connected by designated pathways that allow wildlife to move between them.
And our roadsides, our pathways, become ecological corridors. Sometimes you get two big patches of forest, which are literally right next to each other, but bisected by a small road. And what we do is to help animals cross safely. Rope bridges that tree climbing animals like monkeys, squirrels, colugos will be able to use. Here is a culvert to link one patch of forest across a road to another patch of forest so that ground walking animals, pangolins, civet cats, will be able to use them to cross.
These conservation efforts create safe spaces for animals in the heart of a bustling city.
Now, do you hear that? That is an amazing sound. It's a very beautiful, bubbling sound. And that comes from the straw-headed boo-boo. is globally critically endangered. But in Singapore, if you visit any of our nature parks, it's practically common. We have a native species of parrot called the blue-crowned hanging parrot. It's a very, very beautiful bird. It used to be endangered. Now you can find them practically everywhere. Hornbills, which were extinct in Singapore, they made a comeback. The more big trees you have, the better they breed. Lesser mouse deer used to be impossible to spot. If you know where to go, they are practically a guaranteed sighting.
These national efforts are bolstered by public support. Citizen science programs launched by the National Parks Board help track the growing variety of creatures that now call Singapore home.
Yeah, right in front of you. Do you see it?
Wait.
In front of you.
Oh my God, stay right at me.
Right? Get the front shot, I think that'll be nice.
Got it.
Got it too.
Lumin and Jing Xuan are citizen science volunteers on dragonfly patrol. They're also a couple in fierce competition over their species count.
I have around 80 to 82.
And I'm currently at 91.
I'm catching up.
It gets harder. As you can see, we are a huge green space smack in the middle of apartment blocks, full of people, roads, construction all around. And it just shows how nature can be integrated into our infrastructure and growth.
Even this once barren canal has been transformed. Today, it's a tranquil river lined with greenery and bustling with critters.
They're so cute. Oh, look at that, look at that, look at that.
Singapore's cleaned up waterways now host about 170 otters, and they've become crowd favorites.
We are literally coexisting right beside otters, monitor lizards, birds. And I believe that's great.
Singapore is literally breaking new ground as a city that's embracing both the intrinsic value of nature and its benefits to urban populations. For Khew, it's a validation of all of his hard work and his visionary designs.
Initially, we were considered the emotional tree huggers. People don't understand why we love nature so much. But when we started interacting with young students, there was a cause that they were fighting for. You know, and nature was their cause because this is their future.
That is at the edge.
Oh, I see it, yeah.
Oh, yes, 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 okay.
Singapore is an urban social experiment on how you can bring nature really, really neck and jowl into the urban cityscape. We are learning along the way.
We are strapped for land. The lack of resources actually makes an architect more creative. This is what energizes me to carry on with my green movements, studying butterflies, because knowledge never stops. Whether it's of the biodiverse environment or the built environment.
Thanks for watching this episode. If you'd like to dive deeper into this story or learn how you can help protect biodiversity near you, visit wildhope.tv and come back on Mondays for more Wild Hope right here at PBS Nature on YouTube.